Frank, you've been associated with the jazz convention since its inception. It's now 31 years later. Did you think it would evolve into what this convention's erupted into being?
Well, I suppose the spirit of the convention was always there. And the very first convention was very much like this in spirit, perhaps not in venue and style. So I really didn't think that it was going to do anything else but become like this, because this is what it actually was. But all the sort of things like importations and having Milam Hayes, they were miles away from it. How biggie.
Now, brothers and sisters, my text is found in Matthew, Mark, Luke or John, or Genesis or Revelation somewhere. And it's all about that morning. In that morning, that's gonna be a great change. The Father and the Son gonna be sitting on the throne that morning. And I imagine I can hear the angels all around the throne say, oh, what's the matter this morning? Just about that time, I imagine I can see the Father go down and call old Gable. Oh, Gable, I want you to go down this morning. I want you to place one foot on the land and the other on the sea. I want you to blow that silver trumpet, calm and easy. I don't want you to annoy my people because they once been woken their hearts awake again. I imagine I can see old Gable go down and take that silver trumpet, obeying his Father's commandments. I imagine I can see him place one foot on the land and the other on the sea. I imagine I can see him bust the bell of that trumpet wide open, and his saints gonna meet the Father now. Let us pray, church.
Not only slaves see life as a ceaseless struggle. Not only slaves need the assurance that someone cares or that life has purpose. As one of the old musicians said, don't look to the left or the right, but toil uncomplainingly as God would want you to, and in the end you will be rewarded. So it is enormously appropriate that one of the first great events of this 31st Australian Jazz Convention should take place in this cathedral. And thanks be to God for it, especially at a season when we give thanks for that event which begins God's decisive acts in history to bring man back to himself as he comes into our midst in the Christ child, Jesus the Christ. Let us see this service as an act of thanksgiving for all those gone before us who have given us so much in the making of a music which reaches the deepest recesses of our hearts. And may God bless this great convention and all the celebrations of the week to come.
we got him.
Did you think it would last?
Yes, I was positive it'd last. Because everybody had such a good time. It's because they all got together and there was such a spirit of sort of jazz fraternity, you know. Meeting guys that you didn't know, having a chance to blow with them and propagate various musical ideas. The conventions have been a tremendous catalyst in the formation of a national identity as far as Australian jazz is concerned.
Do you really think they have thrown out musicians?
Oh, absolutely. Okay. No question at all. Smacker Fitzgibbon, when I was staying down there one time, and I was about 22, said, "Oh, you want to come and have a listen to this bunch of guys who are playing? They're not very good, but they're practicing." And it was down in the Fun Palace, whatever that means, at Morty Alec. And here I go, and lo and behold, there's the Bernard Brothers and Titch Bray, plus various assorted fellows. And they're all grunting and groaning away, and I said, "Oh, that's tremendous. Why don't you come to the convention?" And they did, and it was that.
Is that how it happened?
Yeah.
Oh, goodness.
The guest artists for tonight are Bob Bernard and Dick Kerry. I'd like, first of all, to introduce one of the world's leading trumpet players, our own Bob Bernard. And our guest from the convention, from Los Angeles, pianist, an alto horn player, alto trumpet player, Dick Kerry.
In California, you say there's not much out there for jazz.
No, there's no California, they aren't hiring jazz bands, the kind of music I played all my life. There's no need for it, not with discotheques and rock and roll and television keeps people home.
So when you see something like this, even though it's amateurish, do you think it pretends for a...
Well, I think amateurs have a lot more fun than professionals anyway. But this is a job most of the time, and when you're young, you get a lot of pleasure out of playing. And as you get older, those marvelous little parts where everything goes just perfect, they get rarer and rarer because it's your job. But when you're young, they happen a lot, especially when you can drink more, which I used to do. And I had to give it up.
How's the market going for you?
I think it's always going to be a struggle.
Mm.
You know, no one's ever going to come and hand it to you. It's going to, you're going to have to fight for every inch. But I'm stuck with it. I've got to fight for every inch now.
I was very impressed last night with that turnout at the Mine Hall. Hundreds of people outside, and the place was packed inside, and that's something we wouldn't dream of in Los Angeles. Out of the question.
when the jazz convention started, did you think that Australian jazz per se would retain an Australian character? Or has it retained?
Well, that's a curly one. They say overseas that you can smell the gum leaves, when you're doing it, you don't realise this, of course. I think everyone picks out the sort of jazz that he likes best. And my cup of tea's always been small group music, as you know. And to that, I think we must have added a little chapter to the history of jazz in that regard, if nothing else. I find that people like Neville Stribling and myself were happier in that idiom.
Played a tune of yours.
Which one?
Ill Wind.
Ill Wind, it's a funny thing, we were doing a recording session in Melbourne with Lockie Thompson, and he said, what about some originals? And I think I wrote it out on the back of an envelope while we were tuning up. So I'll await results and hear what it sounds like.
Bruce Johnson on trumpet.
Can we do letter G the second time through? And then the third time, Sax, still play your configuration you've got there, and Bobby's taking up the right. This is the second time through G. Pick up that, about right, after three. One, two, three.
Nitch, when you were at the first convention, who did you play with?
This was 1946. Alan Knight was on piano. Stewie Spears, the great rock king, was on drums. Manny Pappas was the trumpet player. He's since died. We thought we were Christmas playing at the jazz convention.
When you think of the first convention and look around you now, what do you think?
Well, the best thing is that 31 years later, the main ideas that were developed in that first convention have been kept and maintained. The idea that people come along of all different standards of playing ability, but they mix and play together and have a good time, and the younger ones learn and the older ones hopefully try to help them in a very good amateur spirit, which is far away different from most jazz festivals around the world, where it's pretty well straight commercial.
Thank you.